Meanwhile, my sample has increased to n equals 100 for chocolate and vanilla cookies. And of course, I always include all available data measured under similar condition and not older than 1 year, even if the calculated minimum sample size of the data collection plan is exceeded. This reduces the confidence intervals and makes the calculations even more reliable. And later, I can compare the data of 1 year before improvement with the data of 1 year after improvement. Seasonal fluctuations can then also be considered, but unfortunately this is often only possible with a great deal of effort. First, I create a graphical summary again with the Minitab assistant. Here I divide my sample by cookie type in chocolate versus vanilla cookies. The separated histograms for chocolate and vanilla cookies, with the expected overlaid normal distribution curve again, indicate a deviation from the normal distribution, different means, and different standard deviations, within the expected data range from 1 equals very good to 6 very bad. The time series plot shows for the vanilla cookies a stationary course of events and for the chocolate cookies a shift in the taste rating from good to bad. This means there is a difference in taste between the two types of cookies. But is this difference statistically significant and practically relevant? We will test this difference later in the hypothesis tests. First, I would like to point out that the time series plots could be transferred to the histograms if we divided the y-axis into the value categories of the histogram and then stacked the data points in the respective categories on the y-axis. Control charts are a special variant of the time series plots. I use the IMR control chart because the 100 data points in the chart can still be mapped well and do not have to be combined to subgroups for the X-bar-R or the X-bar-S chart. And I use the calculation in the before-after control chart of the Minitab assistant. But I don't want to look at changes of one cookie type, but compare the vanilla and chocolate cookies. There is no significant difference between the standard deviations of the two cookie types, but the means of both cookie types differ significantly. The individual values chart shows the time course as in the time series plot, plus horizontal lines for the mean and the calculated upper and lower control limits. And it shows many outliers in red, i.e. ratings that are outside the control limits, and indicate an overall shift in the ratings from good to bad and thus a decrease of the performance. It is noticeable that in chocolate cookies, the very good rated cookies on the bottom of the chart are also indicated as outlier in red. This is because the control limits were calculated based on the data of the overall poor performing chocolate cookies, which raise the control limits here compared to the vanilla cookies. If I choose the upper control limits of the controlled process for vanilla cookies and set the lower control limit to 0, then the bad performance of the chocolate cookies becomes clearer, with even more outliers above the UCL. Further signals in control charts, such as trends, cycles, shifts and drifts, are described later in the control phase. But we can already here make a note of these signals for our root cause analysis to see what the causes of these shifts and extreme ratings were. This also applies to the signals in the MR chart. Here the red data points show strong chronological changes in the ratings of the taste from cookie to cookie. And again the question of the causes for these fluctuations arises. Let us next check the process capability of the chocolate cookies. If the data is nominally scaled, for example in defect versus OK, then you can calculate the yield, defects per unit, defect parts per million and the sigma level. I already introduced the well-known case of 3.4 defects in 1 million units, with one opportunity for a defect per unit. This leads to a long-term sigma level of 4.5 and a short-term level of 6 sigma. If you need to calculate the sigma level for complex products with several different opportunities for a defect, then the index defects per million opportunities, DPMO, is appropriate. If you, for example, assume 100,000 units instead of a million, with 3.4 defects and 10 opportunities for a defect, you will get the same results as calculated before. Every opportunity is treated as a unit, and the total number of opportunities result from the number of units times the number of opportunities. If in another case the performance level is given as a percentage value, for example yield, then you can transform it into a sigma level, and vice versa. If your data is cardinally scaled, normally distributed, And if the specification limits are set, then you can calculate the PP-PPK capability indices and the corresponding sigma level. In our case, however, the data is only ordinally scaled and not normally distributed. Therefore, the indices may only be interpreted with reservation. I enter the data of our chocolate cookies here. The lower specification limit LSL equals 1, which also represents one boundary of our rating scale, and USL equals 4. As determined in the data collection plan, I enter the calculated mean and the standard deviation, and get an estimation of PPK, 0.01, and the corresponding sigma level of 0.03. Both values would even become negative if the mean value were greater than the upper or below the lower specification limit. And many projects I have worked on in the past have started with a negative sigma level. But it doesn't matter where you are today, but what you will have achieved tomorrow. Just try this out for your own processes and you will get a first estimation of their capability. Statistics programs like Minitab calculate set bench values to estimate the sigma level. They are based on the normal distribution and convert cumulated percentage values of one side of the normal distribution into Z values and vice versa. The results of the Minitab Assistant capability analysis first show again the previous entered upper specification limit and the target value from the data collection plan. A lower specification limit is not necessary in our case, as we only fear ratings greater than 4. And we would be happy if all customers would rate our cookies with a 1, which means very good and determines the lower limit of our scale. The actual sigma level, Z-actual 0.01, and the potential sigma level, the best value we could expect under the same conditions without changes, is Z-potential 0.03. The one sample t-test shows that the mean of the ratings significantly differs from the given target value of 1.5 for the taste. This means that we must at least improve the taste of the chocolate cookies. The histogram again shows the distribution of our taste ratings. Additionally, one vertical line indicates our target value and another line the upper specification limit. As you can see, the center of the distribution is far from the target value and many cookies are above the upper specification limit. The poor process capability of our chocolate cookies is therefore also graphically traceable here. Some belts fear that managers might be upset about the documentation of their processes' poor performance. They are therefore considering presenting the results somewhat more positively than they are. But that would not only be dishonest, it also reduces the potential that you can prove in the control phase. The following hypothesis tests are aimed precisely at identifying the levers for this potential: the evaluation of the negative influences on the taste of our chocolate cookies.